All right.
This is for just a little taste.
And are you ready?
I am ready.
All right.
Hello, everybody. My name is Ann Holcomb, and I am the Supportive Services Supervisor for Unity Parenting and Counseling. And Unity Parenting runs 9 programs on the South Side of Chicago. I'll get into a little bit more about what those are, but primarily I'm here tonight to talk about homeless youth. And some of the issues and why it becomes a pressing issue right now. Mike is coming and going, I think. Because of what's going on with state politics. So I'm going to kind of give everybody a primer of what youth homelessness is about and who homeless youth are and what their experiences are. And then I'll shut down the PowerPoint and we'll talk about what is pressing right now and how homeless youth, you wouldn't think, well, homeless youth and state politics, what's that about? Yeah. Well, we're going to talk about what that's about because it's huge, okay? So I'll just kick right in and start in with Homeless Youth 101.
No, I'll just go on.
Okay, whatever you want. I can even pack it for you to go.
No.
So, the rear.
The previous slide showed kind of an abandoned school, and I picked that slide off the internet. And the reason why I picked that slide off the internet was because our Ujima shelter actually is housed in an abandoned school. And when we walked in for the first time, and saw the space after we were turned down by 4 communities in trying to open the shelter, that's kind of what it looked like. It was very decrepit and there was peeling paint and stuff like that. So I thought it was kind of appropriate to have that be the first slide. That's not an actual picture of Ujima because we didn't take pictures of it at that time, but it looks very similar. So first of all, I want to talk about who homeless youth are. And when I talk about homeless youth, I'm talking about youth primarily between the ages of 14 and 24. And the largest number of homeless youth are between the ages of 18 and 24. So when you think about youth, you might think, well, aren't they adults at 18, right? So how many of you are parents in this room? Let's see a show of hands. Some of you, right?
Yeah.
So you probably know that not every 18-year-old is a full-fledged adult. Though they say they're grown, and they may argue with you about being grown, they are not grown at 18. And I know I was not grown at 18. So the thing is they've recently discovered with brain science that the brain is not fully developed, especially in young men, and I see that we have largely a male audience here today. So you may challenge me on this, but it is backed up by the science, that young men maturate at a slower rate than young females, okay? Part of that's due to puberty and childbearing years and all that kind of stuff. And so the frontal lobe of the brain, which is like right here, literally, it's like if you put your hand right here, this is it, right here, okay? That doesn't fully grow until the age of 24, 25. Okay, so that explains why young people have a lot of trouble controlling their impulses sometimes. They make very rash decisions sometimes. They just can't seem to make a plan for their life for 5 or 6 years in advance. All those things are what's called the executive branch of the brain, which takes place in the frontal lobe, where you make kind of executive decisions. When you think about what an executive does, you're strategically planning, you're setting goals for yourself, you're understanding fully what the consequences are and weighing those consequences before you make decisions. And those are all the things that young people struggle with because they just don't have the brain capacity to get there, okay? So when we talk about somebody age 14, they actually have a lot in common with a 24-year-old, okay? So that's why, and as far as homelessness goes, they're often dealing with the very same issues. So homeless youth are on their own without the support of a guardian, okay? Now there are homeless children and families, and there are certainly teenagers that are in family systems and family shelters, but usually when we talk about homeless youth, we're talking about youth that are on the streets by themselves without families. So why do you guys think that youth become homeless? Throw out some stuff.
Divorce.
They age out of the the system?
Age out of foster care and the wards of the state and stuff like that, absolutely.
Yeah.
And you said divorce, absolutely. Fractured homes is huge.
Mental illness.
Mental illness, right. And not only just the mental illness of the kid. I would say on average, over the years that I've been doing this work, and I've been working with homeless youth since 1994, I would say on average, more of the youth I see become homeless because their parents have mental illness than because they themselves have mental illness. So at our Ujima site, because it is what we call a low threshold shelter, it has very few rules, it's really there to catch the kids that can't do a regimented program. We do see a high rate of mental illness, particularly in that program. I would say between 30 and 40% just in that shelter. But now if you look at our transitional living program, it's probably like 2 or 3%, okay, mentally ill. So, you know, it depends. But, yeah, mental illness is a huge factor. Any other reasons?
You know, like a religious thing where, you know, the child might become gay and...
Yeah, and not just about LGBTQ, but yes, there are statistics. There's a nationwide study that was done by the True Colors Foundation, and it replicated a lot of localized studies that have been done since the 80s that say that about 40% of homeless youth are LGBTQ. Not all of them are out of the closet, but that's very true, and that's been true to my experience. But there's more than that about religious differences. I had a straight kid whose parents were Jehovah's Witnesses.
Ooh.
And he just couldn't live the life. And, you know, they kept telling him he was damned. I mean, his self-esteem was about this big because he just couldn't fall in line with their belief system. And he really felt that he should, but he couldn't. And so that was an issue. So there's other types of religious issues. There's kids that either seriously or perhaps as an act of rebellion head towards kind of the pagan, Wiccan, you know, that kind of stuff. And their parents, if they're born-again Christians, will sometimes not tolerate that. So, yeah.
Also, I don't want to be a scanner. So, reason, there's poverty.
Right.
And parents...
She's saying that there's poverty. And poverty is a huge factor in homeless youth, right?
How we can slowly start to solve this problem.
Right. So the issue is that like a whole family will be poor, right? And so when a kid is over 18, it's like, well, the law says I don't have to take care of you anymore and I don't have enough money to feed you. Or even somebody younger, maybe a 17-year-old girl, she gets pregnant. Oh my God, I can't feed you and the baby. You know, I mean, it is huge. Or the whole family is going house to house and the kid finally says, you know what, I'm gonna strike out on my own, because my parents are living in an abandoned building, and maybe at least I can get into a shelter. You know, so yeah, poverty is huge. So you talked about some of the reasons, and I'm gonna go through some more. This is a very good general definition that I found. It's from the National Alliance in Homelessness, and it's called that homelessness for youth is caused by family breakdown, which includes parental substance abuse or mental health problems, child abuse, molestation, or neglect, family conflict, and family homelessness, and system failure. And when I say system failure, it's of the child welfare, foster care, failed adoptions, and that's when, say a kid is adopted when he's like two, and he looks at his adoptive parents as his parents, but the subsidy check from the state, he's in a subsidized adoption, and the subsidy check stops when the kid turns 18. And so then the parents suddenly say, guess what? We're not really your parents. I actually had a young man that I was working with recently who really thought his adoptive parents were his biological parents until his 18th birthday when they hit him with the facts and said, get out. Okay, so there's a lot of financial incentive for particularly people that don't have a lot, families that don't have a lot that are getting that check from the state, and then when that check stops, they kick the kid out. So when I talk about failed adoptions, that's what I'm talking about. Because when you really are somebody's parent, you're their parent for life. You know, I've been a foster parent, and I'm still a parent to one of my foster children. Okay, he still calls me his second mom. He still calls me for advice from time to time. He just bought a house in Indianapolis. I'm really proud of him. So the thing is, and I was his foster parent in the 80s. So So when you're really a parent for life, and failed adoptions is when people forfeit that. So then juvenile justice system. I mean, I had a kid that was released from the Audi home. He'd been in and out of the Audi home since he'd been six, and he still didn't have, he was basically functionally illiterate. He couldn't hardly read and write, and that was certainly a failure of the Audi home system to not educate this child. I don't believe that he had any learning disabilities. I think his primary disability was his environment, and that they just didn't teach him. They didn't encourage him to learn. And then, you know, the kids having themselves mental health or drug issues, and then not having a place to go. Probably many of you know that the mental health system has been shrinking and shrinking in the last 10 years. And so it's really important not to blame the youth themselves, okay? And when the blaming starts, the answers stop, okay? So if you're blaming the youth for being homeless themselves, not saying that youth don't make mistakes, I mean, that's part of youth, right? We all make mistakes. Even adults make mistakes. Let me see a show of hands of how many people here who have not made a mistake in the last couple of years. I think people make mistakes, whether it's forgetting your car keys or something, right? So the thing is youth, of course, are going to make mistakes. They're youth, and they're going to make more mistakes probably than we do. So to blame their homelessness on a kid doesn't make sense. Or even to blame it on somebody that's legally an adult but is a young adult that maybe never had the support that he should have had. So this is a piece. Gene Horker has seen this before. So a long, long time ago. When I was in graduate school, I wanted to look at like one unifying theory of what causes homelessness. And I did a study, and it came out with really strong results. And the reason why is the causes of homelessness for all ages have been heavily politicized. And, you know, under the Ronald Reagan years, it was, you know, pull yourself up by your own bootstraps. Yeah. You know, you made bad decisions, that's why you're homeless. We don't really have real homeless people in the United States, right? And then, you know, then the left-leaning people go on the far other side and say that homelessness is completely caused by the systemic stuff, like lack of affordable housing, unemployment, you know, jobs going overseas, all those things. There's truth to both of those sides. But if you go all the way left, you take away the human agency of the individual to make a change in their life. If you say your homelessness is completely caused by lack of affordable housing and racism and unemployment and bad educational systems, then what is this person sitting in front of you supposed to do with that? Okay, how are they supposed to resolve that for themselves, right? So the truth is in between, all right? So you have systemic causes, you have personal challenges or bad decision making that people make, right? You have, then there's two things that weren't really heavily studied. What I call family legacy, and that's that one thing I found in even older homeless adults, because when I did my study, I sampled people that were even in their senior years. I sampled all ages. And every single person had a loss with a family member, and fairly recently, okay? So, you know, you have someone that has maybe never totally got on his feet, but he's not homeless, but he's lived with his mom his entire life, and then his mom finally dies. And he is just lost in the world, right? You have, you know, and so you have people, and some of the other things that were true in the family legacy issue was violence, a lot of family violence, whether it was domestic violence or whether it was a history of child abuse or something. And maybe the person wasn't even a victim, but it was in the house, and it made the house so chaotic that they weren't getting their needs met because of all the violence, right? And then the other thing is a triggering event, and that's basically what happens between the time the person is housed and the night they become homeless. And that was the least studied of all those levels. I found the least amount of literature. And the sad thing is that's where you could really do some prevention, right? And I dream of a day for homeless youth when there is a 24-hour on-call system of social workers that if a parent is thinking about putting their kid on the house, they can call that person. That person can get to their house in an hour, even if it's 2 a.m, and work with that family to keep that kid housed. And I bet, trust and believe, that I would say at least half these homelessness that I see would be resolved if that happened. Right? So there's a lot of prevention that could happen. You know, fortunately in Chicago we have some pretty good tenant laws, but that's not true with most of the country. So a lot of people are illegally evicted, and there's no basically consequences to the landlord really for doing that, right? Other than the slap on the wrist. So people, you know, there's lots of prevention avenues that could be explored with that level that still are not. But it takes all those four things to make somebody homeless, including a youth. Okay, going back to the question about LGBTQ youth, and that's that since I put this together, True Colors has now verified nationally that about 40% of the youth are LGBTQ. Okay.
Could you tell us real quick what LGBTQ?
Yeah, sure. Lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, and the Q stands for either questioning or queer. Okay, queer is a word that is being reclaimed by our young people. So it's kind of like the N-word. You know, it's appropriate probably for them to say it, but sometimes not appropriate for those of us that are older to say it. Yeah, unfortunately, because of the camera, I'm really locked to where I have to stand.
If you want to move around, we'll follow you.
Okay.
Don't worry.
All right. So about 17% of Chicago's homeless youth reported that becoming pregnant or being a parent was a cause of their homelessness, meaning another baby in the house is one too many, so get out. And when you think about how sad that is, that a parent is actually putting a teen mom on the street with a newborn infant, but it happens every day. And our Harmony Village program is the program that addresses that. It's a 2-year transitional living program, and we have 31 apartments for homeless, primarily homeless teen moms. So there has not been a terribly good study of homeless youth that counts them, but this is one study that was done by the Chicago Coalition for the Homeless that said that there was 10,719 youth in Chicago that were homeless in 2012, making up 9.2% of Chicago's entire homeless population. So basically youth are approximately 9% of all the homeless people that you see, okay? And the reason why I say that youth are really, really hard to count, homeless people are hard to count, but youth are particularly hard to count. So around 2,000 homeless youth are estimated to be on Chicago streets on any given night. But again, that's an estimate, and it's because homeless youth blend in. They survive very differently than homeless adults do. And so you don't generally see a youth sleeping like this on the street, okay? They will look the same as any other youth, and they will do a lot to try to blend in. It's a survival strategy, not to attract predators. So they want to look like everybody else. So 18,669 homeless students were reported in Illinois. Okay, I'm sorry, in Chicago Public Schools, I have an Illinois figure too, it's about 56,000. During the 2012-2013 school year, that's an 8.2% increase over the previous year. And now there's even more. Again, that's 2012-2013. We're in 2014-2015, so that's 2 years difference. And it continues to rise. So as far as unaccompanied homeless youth, 2,512, these are youth that are living on their own on the street or house to house or in shelters. There was 2,512 that were going to a Chicago public school in 2012-2013. And they don't have this year's figures, obviously, yet. And as I was saying, most homeless youth do not look like a stereotype. Okay, most homeless youth do not look like that. You may see a few that do, but very few. Most homeless youth, you could be sitting next to somebody on the red line and not even know, okay? And becoming invisible, blending in, and not looking like a stereotypical homeless person is a survival skill. And also, just youth in general take a lot of pride in their appearance. They're very susceptible to what they see on television and in advertising and the news. They want the new Jordans just like anybody else does. And, you know, some of these youth were my clients. So, just to let you know, they don't really look homeless. I took this picture, and what's really funny is making the rounds on the internet. So I actually took it off the internet, but I took the picture like 3 years ago for Streetwise. So if you ride the CTA train at 3 a.m., that's a way to kind of see who's not going home. And a lot of Chicago's homeless youth feel safer sleeping on the train or in an abandoned building or other places than going to an adult homeless shelter for the night. And I have to say, you've probably heard of Pacific Garden Mission. Mm-hmm. That's the place where if you call the homeless hotline, you know, from a hospital emergency room or a police station, and you say, I'm homeless, I need shelter, that's the go-to place, right? Because they have about 1,000 beds. But I've had 3 youth raped there over the years, 2 boys and 1 girl. And they have these things that are called group showers. They mandate that you take a shower. You have to get completely naked. You go in the shower. They take your clothes away from you and put your clothes supposedly in a hot box to kill any lice or whatever. But they don't give them back to you until the next day. And you go in this group shower, and then the staff just walk away. So anything can happen in those showers with like 20, 30, 40 people in them. And it does.
Was that a mixed shower, men and women?
No. No. Fortunately not, but
that
still bad things
so
happen.
Sorry.
So there are not nearly enough shelter beds for homeless youth. In 2014, there were only 603 youth beds across Illinois, and 396 in Chicago, 117 in the suburbs, 90 downstate. This is a picture that looks a lot like the Night Ministry's Open Door, where they have bunk beds and have like rooms that are shared. Homeless shelters, the low threshold shelters, are more like a traditional shelter where you'll have maybe 8 to 12 beds in a room. And most of the time for emergency shelters, they don't bunk them because we don't know if a female is pregnant or not. And we don't want a female that is pregnant falling out of the top bunk. So we don't bunk the beds. So these are things that you said that they needed the most in a 2005 study that the Coalition for the Homeless did. It's one of the best studies that are out there. Finding a place to live, finding a job, getting regular transportation, finding an apartment, and getting food on a regular basis. On the South Side, food is the number one issue. The South Side, where we have our program, it's in Greater Grand Crossing, but it's where it meets with Englewood and Auburn Gresham. And those are some of the most heavily impacted neighborhoods by poverty. And so you go around, it's a food desert, it's a social service desert, it's really an everything desert. You know, it's where you go down the street and you have one house lived in a block sometimes. And then the next one's boarded up, and then there's a couple empty lots, and there's one that should be boarded up, and so on. And so food is huge because there's not a lot of resources, even soup kitchens, where kids can go. Plus, a lot of kids don't feel comfortable going to adult soup kitchens because they get bullied. So it's a huge issue on the South Side. I worked on the North Side for about 10 years also, and it's not as big of an issue on the North Side. Okay, it's still an issue, but not nearly the crisis. The biggest issue on the North Side is transportation, and I kept hearing that over and over. Besides housing and have a place to stay, transportation was really huge. This just shows you a racial breakdown of homeless youth, and you know what I've seen living all over this country. I've lived in 6 states, and that whatever the racial minority is, they are disproportionately homeless. When I lived in San Francisco, there was a very large number of particularly Chinese Asian homeless, okay? And when I lived in Albuquerque, or close to Albuquerque, that most of the homeless people were of Mexican descent or were Native American, you know, and in Chicago, it's mostly African American. Homeless youth tend to be a little bit more diverse and a little bit whiter than homeless adults, as far as the population goes. The average age of a first homeless experience is 14.7 years old. So most homeless youth, when their first episode of homelessness, when they first get kicked out of the house, is usually not the time that I see them, because usually they just run over to a friend's house and stay there. By the time I see them, they've burned all their bridges with their friends because they've been residentially unstable for a really long time, probably have spent some time on the street, probably tried to live in an abandoned building and got too cold. You know, so, you know, homelessness is not just, okay, you get kicked out, you go to a shelter. One of the things that homeless youth do a lot of times is build a street family. I know of only one on the south side, but on the north side that was huge. I knew a lot of very distinct street families where some of the more experienced, more street savvy youth, not necessarily older, but sometimes older youth, would be made parents, and they would be addressed as my mom, my dad. The other youth would be addressed as my brother, my sister, my cousin. So I only know of one street family that we have cycling in and out of Ujima, but it's a pretty large one. So there's also a subset of homeless youth that are travelers, and they live kind of like the hobos did in the Great Depression. And some of them are kind of semi-homeless by choice. Usually there's a lot of issues why they became homeless in the first place, but they tend not to want social services, and they tend to ride the trains, hitchhike. They often have a challenge to see how dirty they can get. So if you see some really dirty kids wearing like army fatigue type colors or grays and blacks, and they're on the corner and they often have pets with them, they are probably travelers. So this is the thing about prostitution, and I'm just gonna go a little faster because I wanna get to the state budget stuff. But about one third of homeless youth in the US engage in survival sex, and most of the time they don't identify as prostitutes. And they're not standing on the street corner, they're not putting ads on Craigslist. What they're doing is somebody will stop and say, hey, you need a place to stay, and the person will say yes, and I'm saying person because it's both boys and girls that do this. And, you know, it doesn't matter what their sexual orientation or preference is, they will have sex to get a shower, they will have sex to get something to eat, they will have sex to get a couch to sleep on. And sometimes the youth don't know that that's going to be the expectation when they get in the car and go to the person's apartment. So that's a huge thing. And this came from a billboard. I took a picture of a billboard that was on the CTA trains a couple years ago. It said, children all over Chicago will be forced to blank for a bed tonight. Oh, 45% of homeless youth reported having a mental health problem of some sort during the last year, including PTSD and depression. And let's face it, homelessness is both traumatizing and depressing. I think that if you're actually on the street and you're a homeless youth and you're not depressed, then I would kind of wonder if something is wrong, to be honest, in working with the youth, because it's depressing, it's frustrating, it makes you angry. And, you know, if you go around with this facade that, oh, everything is wonderful and I'm homeless, you know, then there's a whole lot of layers that someone would have to get underneath to help that individual. So suicide and threats of suicide are huge in the homeless population, especially LGBTQ youth. Homeless youth are more likely to use drugs, including marijuana and crack. And a lot of times they do it as self-medication. And I actually would like to see a study someday of the therapeutic benefits of marijuana on PTSD. I have not seen it. The veterans community is calling for this. And anecdotally, I have seen it among particularly homeless young men. And there are men that I can work with if they smoke. I don't mean they come in totally high. I mean, they had a little smoke that morning, and then they're ready to come in and talk about housing, job, school, you know, getting their ID, stuff like that. And I think it helps mitigate some of the effects of the trauma, and I'd really like to see a study on that. I'm not saying it's a cure, and I don't think people should be potheads for life, but at the same time, you know, if it helps them get through something and it helps me be able to work with them, then there might be something to it. And I really hope, I'm looking forward to the veterans study that's coming out about that. Okay, 3 in 5 Illinois homeless youth reported being victimized by violence during the course of 1 year.
Thank you, Barbara.
And in the United States, 13 homeless youth die on the streets every day.
Yeah, do you?
So people don't think about homeless youth dying, but they do. During the time that I worked for the night ministry, I lost one youth a year, and that same number seems to be repeating at Ujima. Ujima shelter's been open for 2 years, and I've lost one youth each year. One youth was shot. It was a case of mistaken identity. He was a bucket boy making money by playing drums, you know, with a plastic bucket on one of the entrances to the expressway. And he was wearing a black hoodie, and somebody came along and just shot at him thinking he was somebody else. And then the other young man was involved in a domestic disturbance. He was actually trying to defend his mother. Can y'all read that? It says, what doesn't kill you makes you stronger. And this is a quote that's been quoted from Muhammad Ali as well as several other people, including Gwendolyn Brooks. I'm not sure where it originated, but it's wonderful. And it's what we try to do at Unity Parenting and Counseling. And that's that service to others is the rent you pay for your room here on earth. And so we're trying to pay for our room as staff, our room here on earth, by providing human rights to homeless youth. I guess I'll just leave that slide up because I'm going to shift gears. I want to pass these out a little bit here. What I'm passing out is about, oh, you're going to pass that for me? Okay. Cool. Just get, try to give me one so I'll talk from in here. Thank you. So right now, you know there isn't a state budget. Y'all, how many people have known about the state budget crisis and have been following the news? No, not too many. Okay. So Governor Rauner has refused to sign a state budget, okay? And I'm going to be bipartisan here because the Democrats had some opportunities to fix this problem 10 years ago and even a year ago. And they didn't. And now we have this huge, huge hole for our budget. So Governor Rauner is basically saying, however, that he's not signing a budget, not just because there's this big, huge hole in the revenue. We're not, the state is not bringing in enough revenue for all the expenditures. Okay, and that's true. Both parties agree to that. Both the Democrats and the Republicans agree that there is not enough revenue coming into the state to meet the expenditures. So, but the problem is, he's also tying this to this thing he calls the turnaround agenda. Have any of you heard the word turnaround agenda in the news? Yeah. So the turnaround agenda is basically a lot of anti-union stuff. I mean, one of the bills that's involved in that would basically say that if you work in a company that has a labor union, and you work on the line, so to speak, and you don't want to join the union, there's still fees that you have to pay right now. And he wants to eliminate that. Even though if, being a non-union member, you're still getting all the benefits of collective bargaining. So, you know, if they go out on strike, you might not go out on strike, but when they win the strike, you're going to get the raise. So that's one of the things that's part of the turnaround agenda. Now, what does that have to do with homeless youth? Well, the problem is a lot of homeless youth shelters get state funding. And the Ujima shelter that I've been talking about, which is the only homeless youth shelter on the south side of Chicago, and you think about the south side as being huge, right? It's the only shelter. And there hasn't been one before we opened for over 30 years. And so we get 98% of our funding from the state. So that's really huge. And we would be closed right now. It looked like we were going to have to close September 1st. And we are not closed because the city of Chicago gave us a temporary reprieve and basically said that they will fund us with the hope of getting the state funds. And they'll fund us until December 30th, but then after that, they can't do it anymore if they're still not a budget. So the other problem, so we have this problem that we don't have a budget. Then the other problem is that there are a couple, there's actually three different budget proposals floating around in Springfield. And the way this impacts homeless youth is, one of those proposals is cutting homeless youth shelters by 1%. And that's something that most organizations, even UGMA, could live with. You know, especially if, like, the congregations and the individuals and so forth that support us know that this is happening, we can make up 1% of our shelter costs, all right? And, but then another budget says that they're going to cut homeless youth funding by 50%. Now, that we couldn't make up, okay? And then another budget proposal zeroes out homeless youth funds altogether. So we don't know where Governor Rauner is ultimately going to land on this issue. And it's really huge because he doesn't seem to understand that in cutting a lot of human services, including services to seniors, which some of you may know about, right? And including services to autistic children, including services to home care for people that have disabilities. All these things are really huge. And in cutting them, you're almost costing more money in the long run. And I'm going to talk about how that's true with youth. So homeless youth programs tend to work. 82% of youth who receive services move on to safe, stable housing. So that's a really high success rate. Even the federal government doesn't expect that. They, for our transitional living program, they only want 50%, but we exceed it every year, right? And this is true across the board with all the state programs. This 82% is a figure for the whole state. So, and 62% of the youth that were in these programs left with either education or a job or both. So when you think about how, and then the rest of the youth are probably mentally ill to the point where they would get SSI, you know, so that's also huge. That 62% of the youth leave with a job. These are kids that probably never had a job before. These are kids that never had a chance to finish high school, and now they're doing it, right? So they work. Now, the cost of a homeless shelter, if you're putting a youth in a homeless shelter or housing, for 1 year is $16,000, okay? The cost of putting that youth in DCFS for a year is $48,000. The cost of putting that youth in a mental hospital is almost $128,000. The cost of a nursing home is $62,000. The cost of incarcerating the kid in juvenile hall is $111,000. If the kid is older and is over 18, Cook County Jail is $52,000. And state prison is $38,000. So you can look at the paper and figure out the math. A homeless shelter is a hell of a lot cheaper, right? But there's also the long-term social consequences and social costs if you don't address youth homelessness. Because if you intervene in the lives of a youth, they don't become a homeless adult. They don't die prematurely. And the average age of a chronically homeless person dying on the street is 42 years old. So think about that. You have a kid right now that's 21. We intervene in his life and set him on the right foot. He leaves us with housing and a job and maybe a high school diploma, right? And he's okay. He's probably not going to become homeless again, probably, right? And even if he does, he's got more resources, and he'll get back on his feet. So, but if we don't intervene in the life of that kid, he's going to go to a mental hospital, or a nursing home, or Cook County Jail, or prison. Because homeless youth will do, they'll survive by any means necessary, okay? You know, nobody wants to die. If they're hungry, they're going to steal to eat, or they're going to prostitute themselves, right? If they're cold, they're going to break into somebody's car or somebody's house. And I don't blame them. They have a right to live. So that's what this is about. So, you know, Governor Rauner's plan to cut programs and then not even have a budget is going to impact this generation of kids, these kids that could be somebody. And just, I want to close with this, final note, I was a homeless youth in the 80s, okay? I have a master's degree. I've graduated at the top of my class. I own a building, it's a four flat. I provide affordable housing to other people. So I'm a living example of what homeless youth can accomplish. I have the blessing of having watched a whole generation of homeless youth when I worked on the north side resolve their homelessness. Many of them communicate with me on Facebook on a daily basis. And they show me their college diplomas. And they show me their registered nursing certificates. And one of them bought a house in Winnetka. My foster son in the 80s was a homeless youth. He came out of the closet. His mother, I knew from a job, called me and said he ran away from home. Can you find him? I knew he was gay. I knew there were two gay bars in Indianapolis at that time. I went to the parking lots of both of them and I found them and I took him in and I became his legal guardian so he could finish school, right? So he has a house in Indianapolis. He has a career. He's a sales rep for a tech company. Been there for 20 years almost. So, you know, these kids do have a future. Now, I was homeless during a time when there were no programs and in a place where there were no programs. I wasn't homeless here. I was homeless in Indianapolis. And I was part of a street family of 9 kids. I was the only one to make it to 30.
Did you have parents or sisters or brothers?
I have a sister who was also homeless, and she's still alive. She's in Ohio.
Where's your parents
who was? My father was psychotic, so that was the cause of my homelessness.
And your mother?
A battered wife. So, yeah, I didn't have family to go to. So the thing is I'm just telling you that if there are no programs, these youth are going to die. That's the bottom line. Or they're going to end up in jail if they're lucky, or in a mental hospital if they're lucky. So I'm asking all of you to pressure Governor Rahner, tell your communities about this. I'm sure everybody here is attached to somewhere else, whether it's a church or Toastmasters or a humanist society or something. Tell the people around you. He has a 39% approval rating right now. It was just in Cranes. People are liking what Governor Rahner is doing. Ask everybody to wake up and smell the coffee.
Let's stay up and take questions.
Brom, do you have any questions?
Okay, Brom, the first
questions, anybody?
The first question I have, and I think you may have partially answered it already, is how you got into this field and why you're doing it, but I think you may have answered that. Can you elaborate a little more?
Yeah, he asked me how I got into this field and why I do what I do. Well, this is an interesting thing. I got into it by accident, for real. In 1989, I had been about a year or so out of homelessness. I had a little apartment that was decent. I'd just been promoted to a retail job. I was a supervisor, and I was online for a management training program. And I did ultimately become a manager, and they moved me to Chicago. So that's how I ended up in Chicago. So I was very, very lonely because my peers were dying, and they were not succeeding. Okay? And I didn't know anybody like me that had made it out of the gutter. And so I joined this group called Housing Now, the National March on Washington, wanting to meet somebody like me. But what happened is I didn't meet anybody like me. Okay? I met a lot of good-hearted people, mostly from the Indianapolis suburbs, that wanted to do something about homelessness. Right? And I met some people that were currently homeless that maybe I gave some hope to. Right? That were from some shelters that went on the National March in Washington. But when I got off the bus in Washington, D.C., for some reason, the media just came and got in my face. There were a couple TV cameras. One was NBC. It was on national news. And I was interviewed, and I had to make a split-minute decision of what I was going to do. Was I going to talk about my own experience, or was I going to pretend to be one of the nice yuppies from the suburbs that wanted to do something about homelessness? So I told the truth. And I said, I was a homeless youth. I've been stable now for about a year, and we need more housing. And we were fighting Ronald Reagan at that point. He didn't want to renew the the McKinney Act, which is the primary federal source of funding for homelessness across the nation, and that's what the march was about. And so that turned me into an activist, and one of the activists that was there who was in charge of the march, his name was Mitch Snyder, he was a resident of Washington, D.C., picked me out because he'd seen me on TV, and he said, you know, you was such a good spokesman, all this other stuff, and he said, you need to do something about homelessness, and you need to figure out a way to get to New York, Chicago, Cincinnati, or San Francisco, because that's where you could really do something. Those are the cities where stuff is going to happen, and change is going to lead the way for the country. And so when the store had it, the store I was working for, there was another store coming open in Chicago, guess what? I applied to be the manager of that store, and they moved me here. And so I worked for them for a couple more years, then started working for nonprofits, went to graduate school, became a social worker, and I have never looked back. I cut my income in half, by the way. Retail, I made a lot more money, but I'm really glad I made the choice.
Did you be able to afford the rent? You can jump, but it was enough to pay to. How, where did you live? You rent studio or you live with somebody? How?
Well, where now I own a four flat.
Yeah. When transition from the homeless.
Right.
Where did you
it was in and out. So I was literally on the street. I mean, I literally slept on a park bench in this park that was called University Park. There was no university there. It was in downtown Indianapolis, only a couple of blocks from Monument Circle. And there were a lot of homeless youth that slept in that park at the time. And so there was a community that could watch my back until I learned some street smarts, because I went there with no street smarts.
But it was cold.
It was cold. Then I lived in an abandoned building for a while. I figured out ways to keep warm. I used to set a wood fire in this abandoned stove that had been left in the place and vent it with the transom. So I always smelled like smoke when I went to work for a while. Then I stayed in a couple of pay-by-night hotels. They were really awful. I had some problems getting jumped in the hallway. Like I said, I didn't go into homelessness with a lot of street smarts. I didn't come from poverty, and I didn't know how to get food stamps. I didn't know how to watch my back. I didn't know all these things. So I had to kind of learn how to survive the hard way.
What about hostels?
There weren't any at that time. And they cost money. You know? So I was making minimum wage, but I was also trying to get my stuff back from a landlord that had cheated me. So he was holding all my stuff, including my family pictures and my great-grandfather's tintype and stuff like that. I just was bound and determined to get my stuff. I did get it back. It took me about 6 months, but I got it back. Used legal aid for law. So, yeah.
Sid Cohen, and then Charlie Nada, and David.
Did you ever make a study of any other country that does better than the United States as far as homelessness is concerned?
That's a really good question. And this is interesting, because one of the things I do in my building is I house international students. And I have a Saudi Arabian student living with me right now. And he tells me there's absolutely no homelessness in Saudi Arabia. And their culture is such that they would not allow it. You know, their Muslim faith, the imam would take the person into his own home, and apparently has, from what the young man has explained to me. That, you know, when tragedy struck a family, the imam took care of the problem. They took the person into his home. We've seen nobody on the street. But there's also some payoffs to that are not so good, okay? Like, if you shoplift, you can get your hand chopped off, literally. You know, literally, they have state-sanctioned corporal punishment to the effect where, they still, I don't know how often they do them, but they're still allowed to do stonings of people. So there's pluses and minuses, I think, to every form of government. And one of the pluses of our government is that we have a lot more freedom of choice. We have freedom of choice to vote for president and maybe vote for Donald Trump or Hillary Clinton. You know, they don't have that choice in Saudi Arabia, all right? They have a king, and he basically calls all the shots. But the thing is we also, I'm old enough to remember when there wasn't mass homelessness, okay? There have been periods in America's history before when there was. Obviously, the Great Depression is one, right? The 1883, around the time we had the World's Fair here, when the World's Fair closed, there was a huge homeless crisis in Chicago. You know, so, but we haven't always had it. And for many years, and I understand that homelessness came to smaller cities like Indianapolis a little bit later, so around the time I became homeless, which was 1985, that's when homelessness started becoming a big problem in Indianapolis. Here it was really like 78, 79. But before that, there wasn't mass homelessness. There wasn't. You know, you had your skid row, but people had a roof most of the time.
Can I have a, never mind.
Okay, in this order. Charles, Sid.
Thank you, my friend.
You just had a question. Kevin, you're loosening it, man.
And David.
Yes, Ann. If the conservative libertarians then at the federal and the state level.
So what?
Don't feel like funding.
Of course you can. What do you want? This is your place.
Social services. And adopt the libertarian position. What would happen to social services in the United States or in the state of Illinois? I mean, they're saying you can just rely on charity. And
right. So one of the advantages of going to grad school and being academically gifted is that I was able to do two different theses. One was the causal level study, and one was the history of homelessness study of Chicago going back to 1837. And so one of the things I wanted to research was that very question. What was it like before the New Deal? Before there were services, okay? And actually there were some services, the trend actually started before the New Deal. It started around 1900 when government started taking a more progressive role in doing stuff that we now call human services, okay? And some of it was public kindergarten and some of that stuff. The Jane Addams era. Okay, when you had people like her that were advocating for the stuff. So the thing is, though, is we literally had people starving in the streets. And private philanthropy under capitalism is never going to be able to fulfill the need, or willing. Let's put it that way. There are some people that probably have, including Governor Rahner, he has nine homes, right? Governor Rahner has nine homes. One of them is a penthouse that he uses only for storage, and it looks out over Maggie Daly Park. For real, he doesn't live there. He doesn't even use it as a guest house, it's full of boxes. So, I know a real estate agent, that's why I know that. So anyway, the funny thing is you have that discrepancy between those that are wealthy and those that are poor, and when I say funny, I'm saying gallows humor funny, right? But the thing is people like Governor Rahner are never going to give one of their nine homes to the homeless, right? It's just not gonna happen. And so that's why we need, in a capitalist economy, we need government to take a role to fill that need. And history proves it. I mean, people that know their history know what life was like before and even during Jane Addams, and know that we had people starving in the streets. Did you know before Cabrini-Green was built? Y'all think Cabrini-Green was horrible, right? Well, it was a hell of a lot better than what was there before. It was largely an Italian slum that was cold water flats, if they had water at all. They actually had a polluted well that where they had a pump, and there were outhouses, okay? They had no, most of the buildings had no running water, and if they had running water, it was just cold water. And that was what they tore down in the 40s, 50s, and 60s to build Cabrini-Green. And so you can see in that instance that Cabrini-Green, paid by our government dollars, was a lot better than the shingle tenements that were there that had outhouses that could have caused all kinds of sanitation issues for the whole city.
Okay. All right. Charles?
You just called on him.
Oh, Charles. Okay. Sid?
I just used
to... Okay. Then David and then...
What is being done for homeless youth by religious organizations and charitable organizations such as the Catholic Charities, Misericordia, the Lutheran organizations, and certain other ones.
Okay, the Catholic Church is probably the most proactive. They have this really dynamic program, which also got state dollars, so I don't know how long it's going to stay in business, because it was about half funded from the state and half came from the Archdiocese and the membership. But it was out of St. Sabina, and I have had more youth get jobs that had all kinds of barriers to employment. I'm talking about special needs youth that got jobs, right, in that program than I've had anywhere else, okay? Just kind of give them a shout out for that. And also, if you guys want to know who the best GED teacher is in the city, it's Adriana Collins at Broadway Youth Center. That's totally different, but I just had to say that. Because if you're lifting up best practices, St. Sabina is the best practice when it comes to an employment program that works for extremely disadvantaged youth. Not just homeless youth, but any youth that comes in there that needs help, they will help them, all right? The Lutherans, not so much. They have a lot of adult programs. Misericordia is mostly for people with disabilities. Not so much. Catholic Charities does some stuff. They're a semi-autonomous nonprofit. They get money from the Archdiocese. They also get government money. They run the homeless hotline for the whole city that serves all ages. So if a homeless person your age or even a youth becomes homeless, they would go to a hospital emergency room or a police station, call 311, say you're homeless, you're connected to the homeless hotline, and then the Catholic Charities brings a van to that hospital and picks you up and takes you to the nearest shelter bed, which often, unfortunately, is Pacific Garden Mission, okay? But they will take people to other facilities. It's just the other facilities aren't as large, and they frequently, all the beds are full, so that's why everybody ends up at PGM. So they do a pretty good job of that. I have to say they probably have done a better job than when that was actually run by city employees. Catholic Charity's been running it for about 3 years now, and it seems to be working better.
All right.
Me, right?
Quinn.
The Department of Justice last month said that homeless people can live in the street, and and the local governments are against it. The local governments are against it, and the poverty lawyers are saying that they have a constitutional right to live in the street. But there's sanitary problems. There's safety. It's wrong. That's the Obama administration doing this.
Right. And I understand why they said that, because I don't know if you guys follow the news, but there was this Catholic priest that was in Southern Florida. I forget whether it was Miami, but it was one of the bigger cities in Southern Florida that's a resort city. It could have been. And he was jailed for putting sandwiches out on the street in a park. Okay? And then the homeless people were also jailed for taking a sandwich. So it's extreme situations like that that are just beyond the pale of ridiculousness is what brought this attention to the Justice Department. So that was the thing that was punching the Justice Department to say, we got to do something about this. I've had youth that have been locked up for a week for public urination. Okay? You know, there's no bathrooms on the south side. There's no businesses. I mean, there's a, you know, your McDonald's are even, you know, about 10 miles apart. Okay, so where do you go? So you try to go behind an abandoned building and you relieve yourself. And this boy got locked up and the police kept him for a week. And I mean, I was looking all over for this kid. He was one of our model clients. You know, he had a job interview. He was going to GED classes faithfully, all this stuff. And he just fell off the wagon because the police had kept him in a lockup for a week. And nobody knew he was there. So, it's one of those things. You don't have any rights unless you fight for them, right? So that's why they made that determination. But I don't think anybody is saying, including the Justice Department, that having people on the street is a solution. This is why we need more housing, why we need more different types of shelters.
Oh, I have a question.
Oh, well, that's too bad. Carl is next.
During your talk, you had mentioned you have a shelter that's in the Grand Crossing neighborhood, right, you said?
Correct. It's at 7320 South Yale.
Right. are there people there like right now, and how many does it sleep? And
Right, it has 24 beds.
How does it work? Is there like a head person there all the time? Or?
Yes. So, well, me and the program manager are kind of the head people, okay? I also am having to do a lot of fundraising, though I hadn't used those skills since the 90s, because of the state budget problem, right? So I'm trying to fill as many gaps as I can. I've been writing a lot of grants and been doing a lot of office hours, which kind of takes me away from what I really want to do, which is be with the kids. But that's the reality of it. I can write a grant, and I've gotten some funded, so I'm going to keep doing that now.
Like, how many people are...
Right, there's 24 beds.
Okay, that's what I want.
Our average census right now is about 18. We tend not to be that full during warm weather, okay? And part of that is because, you know, just things are a little bit more casual in the summertime. You know, we do fill up very full. We've had turnaways, but fortunately with Catholic Charities, we never had to put a youth on the street. Catholic Charities will bring a van and come and pick up our overflow youth and take them to another facility. We have 3 staff on at all times when the youth are awake, and 2 when they're asleep. Okay. And we serve all genders, including transgender.
Actually, I have solution, maybe.
During the rebuttal period. During the rebuttal period.
No.
You might ask.
Yeah, during the
reaction.
Not solution. Go ahead.
Okay, very quick. So, listen. No, I don't want to be on camera, please. It's my choice. I'm too shy. Sorry. So listen. That's right. Okay, so listen. And Gary and a couple miles from Gary, or even in Gary, Miller, and I don't want to be on camera. Okay, Miller, whatever. I forgot the name of the... It's so many abandoned houses. We drive with my husband, because we used to stay in Indiana, you know, so... many abandoned houses, even close to train station. Why don't government, why somebody give idea to the government to provide some houses for those homeless kids?
Yeah, that is not a new idea. It's a wonderful idea, and I ask the same question every day as I drive around Greater Grand Crossing in Englewood, and I see one occupied home in every block. I agree with you. I do have to say that youth are a little different than adults. I would recommend that if the government do that, that would be really awesome for a lot of homeless families.
Yeah, but
as a youth, I lived in an abandoned building and it was no picnic, okay? It really was no picnic. I worried about frostbite. I did get frostbite. You know, I was cooking. I had to bring in snow for water and have it melt. I had a wood fire in what was an abandoned range. And I opened up the transom so I could have a chimney, okay? So, I mean, it was no picnic. But the thing is, and I didn't really have the skill right away. I did fix that building up, by the way, to some extent. But the thing is a lot of people don't have the skill, and I didn't have the skill to do it right? So the government could do it, but I think they need to do it for an older population, because a lot of youth, a lot of times the trauma that the youth have stops them in their tracks. So if a youth is traumatized at age 12, their social development stays at age 12 until that is rectified, yep. Right? And so they don't really have the life skills to even maintain an apartment sometimes. They frequently get evicted. Like, they have this thing called rapid rehousing, which really works really well for the adult population now, so that you're in a shelter for a very short period of time, just so you're on a wait list, and then they give you an apartment, and within 3 months, you're supposed to be able to pay the rent. None of my youth make it. In 3 months, they can't pay the rent. They're not making enough income, and they're also not budgeting, because they don't know how. And they don't have a parent to stand over them and say, save your money.
And sweep the floor.
At least 2 supervisors need to be. So many social workers coming, finish college,
okay.
And a degree.
Okay,
and they don't have a job. It's going to be good use. If 2 adults and some group of homeless, and everybody stops who supervises.
Mom, is there anything we can do to quiet this woman down?
I think she's full of enthusiasm.
Can we ask nicely?
Give her a tranquilizer.
Take a
No, if other people have to raise their questions.
Don't rebuttal, Ileana.
I don't know why.
Okay.
He finds it hard.
Kevin, quick.
Why is the government importing poverty? We're getting millions from Mexico and South America, now he wants to bring all these refugees from Syria. They're all poor, and we got enough poor.
Yeah, I'm afraid that question is a little beyond my scope of expertise because I work with, right, but these are not homeless youth. These are refugees, and they're usually in family systems. And yeah, a lot of them are, yeah. So it's not, we haven't seen any Syrian refugees or any refugees at Ujima. What we're seeing is our domestic, what they call it, displaced person, when it's domestic refugees. They're youth primarily from the south side of Chicago, as far south as Roseland, as far east as Hyde Park, far north as Hyde Park, and as far west as, you know, some of the western suburbs that are southwestern suburbs are coming to us because they are born and bred Chicagoans. Some of them have never even seen the lake. Many of them have never eaten in a restaurant or gone to a movie theater. So one of the things I do is I try to do some enrichment activities and give them field trips and stuff like that so that they have some experiences and can feel comfortable navigating outside of the neighborhood that they grew up in where every other house is an abandoned building.
Okay. Brian?
Nicholas?
Oh.
He's not here.
Oh.
Yes. Go ahead.
I'm Kevin Quinn.
You're Kevin Quinn. Well, I've been calling
this gentleman stole my name, and
he's
he's anti-Obama. But in any case, I know at the say the juvenile center, if a youth is released by the court, they can't release him unless it's to a parent or guardian. And I think you mentioned
that's the biggest scam on the planet. It's the biggest scam. So I had somebody from Jesus is when I worked at Night Ministry, which has been about 3 years ago. Somebody from Juvenile Justice that was in their outplacement center called me, and they said, "I'm trying to reach the parent or guardian of Joe Schmo." I'm just going to make up a name. I remember the child's name, but I'm going to put it out here. And I said, "Well, I'm not the parent or guardian. This is a homeless shelter." And he goes, "Well, he says you're his parent." And I was like, "No, I'm not his parent." And he goes, "Well, we're releasing him to you, and you need to accept him." So a lot of times parents will say they'll take their kids in, but say mama's on crack. You know, mama's on crack. So sure, she wants her son to come home, and maybe she stays sober for a couple days, but then it starts all over again. You know, a lot of times youth that get out of juvie have a lot of issues adjusting, and they don't have a lot of mental health care out here for them to have help with adjusting. And so sometimes a mother that has the best of intentions and the biggest heart in the world just can't handle her kid. You know, he's got institutionalization issues now. You know, so, I mean, juvenile hall puts a whole other layer of complications in a kid's life.
But you mentioned the boy that was held, I think, at the police station by the police, you said.
Yeah, the kid that peed in the grass and they kept him for a week, right.
Was that because they could not find somebody to release him to?
No.
And are you involved?
He was over 18. He was 18. What the issue was is he didn't have a state ID card. And they were basically saying it's against the law not to have an ID card. And they were trying to prove that he was somebody else. He kept telling them what his real name was. But they were trying to close a case or something, and they thought he was this other person. And when they finally realized he wasn't the other person, that he really was who he says he was, they finally let him out.
But do you have much contact with the police or the justices who are trying to release a youth, but they can't just put him out on the street? For legal reasons, I think. They've got to put them somewhere.
Yeah, we've had youth come in with monitoring anklets on to Ujima. You know, we'll take them. You know, I mean, I hate to see a kid sit in juvenile hall, you know, when we have a shelter that has an open bed. You know, and of course we're taking over 18-year-olds, but there are some 18-year-olds that are being released from juvenile hall.
All right, Charles Paydoff.
Yeah, Sam, the last time we had this topic at the College of Homelessness, we were trying to ascertain what is a minimal expense
to have basic living for a single individual in the city? And I see you have a figure of 16,000. I mean,
Those figures were for a
year. And I realize it may bring in food stamps, whatever, but what figure would you place on the base? We also hear living wage. What the heck is, how much do I need to make at Walmart's in terms of a living wage?
Okay, so I can answer that pretty quickly. The average studio, not saying you can't find them cheaper because I rent my garden unit, which is a one bedroom, for a lot less. But the average studio apartment in Chicago is $800 a month. The average one bedroom is now $1,100. Okay? I'm not sure what the average two bedroom is, going up from there. So basically, the federal government establishes, and I think this is probably pretty good information, that one third of your income should be spent on housing. So if the average apartment, a studio apartment for a single individual, costs $800 a month, then times that by three, and that's how much you need for a month.
Yeah.
Okay.
Good luck.
Right. Because, you know, taxes are 20%.
Okay.
Right? Taxes are 20% of your paycheck. All right.
I've had some experience in, you know, some friends of mine, like right now I got a friend who's living out of his office because he's underemployed because he can't find rent, but he's doing everything he knows how to do. He's an adult in his mid-50s, divorced, that type of thing. And but you know, he's getting by,
right.
You know, and he's moving forward. I have another friend of mine who lives in a trailer park out in Sycamore. He too is getting by, but he just brought in, you know, his partner, which was, she died not too long ago, and he just brought in her daughter, and she's about 38 years old. She has been evicted out of two apartments for non-cleanliness. She refuses to work. How, a person like me, is there anything I can do to get this gal, or to help my friend, or to help this gal out?
Some of these things are very hard to get in the middle of. Okay, mm-hmm. I mean, I would recommend to your friend, if she's living like that, she clearly has mental illness.
Right.
I mean, people don't go around stinking because it's cool, and it's gonna win you friends and influence people, right? So when people have really poor hygiene, frequently, not always, it's either a sign of very, very severe depression, major depression, or even major psychotic depression. Okay, or it's a sign that they've been raped. And the rape could have happened when they were two. Mm-hmm. Or one. And maybe they don't even remember it. Okay? So there's a real, as far as symptomology goes for mental illness, mm-hmm. I'm not too proud to say that I've read the diagnostic manual backwards and forwards a couple of times, because I have to. But, you know, it's symptomology for the not bathing thing is symptomology for one of those three things, usually. Okay? And sometimes depression overlays other mental illness, like schizoaffective disorder, schizophrenia, you know, all those things. So sometimes people have more than one mental illness. So what I would strongly suggest, if you know someone who is dealing with a situation like that, strongly encourage them to try to get the person into mental health care, which is easier said than done, I know. Resources for free mental health care are almost non-existent. If they're not suicidal or a danger to other people, you can't put them in a hospital against their will. We even have that trouble in the shelter. You know, we had a kid that was a firebug. He went around flicking his lighter all the time, and he's like talking to the flame. Okay, on this lighter. And he clearly was schizophrenic. I mean, he's hearing voices and talking to lighter flames and stuff like that. He ultimately torched our dumpsters. Then we could get him into the hospital. But before that, he was in our shelter for 3 or 4 months. And there was nothing we could do except try to encourage him to go. We did hook him up to Friends Family Health Center, which is part of University of Chicago. And we pulled the string and got him a therapist, but he never would go. You know, And people are not thinking rationally, so they're not going to make the rational decision, which is to go get help mental health care, you know? Mm-hmm. And youth tend not to get mental health care, period. They tend not to go see doctors unless it's they break their leg or something that they have to go to the emergency room for. I mean, youth just don't go to other places. So what we need for our shelter is actually a psychologist or psychiatrist that can assess, diagnose, and treat, that would make the rounds of all the low-threshold youth shelters. We have a network. We already are working together, you know, the west side one and the north side ones and so forth. We just had one to make the rounds. Then when these kids get kicked out of my shelter because they keep flicking their lighter on people's faces and they go stay at La Casa Norte on the west side, that clinician can follow them and provide them some continuity of care, right? So that's a solution for homeless youth. It would not be terribly expensive. We're talking probably about $120,000 a year.
Yeah, George, how do us? How would you deal with a homeless beggar in the street? What I do is I give him some money, but then I say, well, you can see, you can hear, you can walk, you know, I try to make a positive move.
So there's been lots of studies done on panhandlers because they're so visible, right? A lot of panhandlers aren't homeless. A lot of them are mentally disabled, either with developmental learning disabilities, developmental meaning mental retardation, learning disabilities like very severe dyslexia, attention deficit disorder, those kinds of things, maybe Asperger syndrome, autism. And then sometimes it's mental health, bipolar disorder, schizophrenia, all those kinds of things. So they're living probably on SSI. So a lot of the people you see on the street are not literally homeless, but you try to live on $700 a month. That's what you get with SSI, actually $720 now. You know, when the average studio apartment is $800 a month, right? So they're out there begging to supplement their SSI. Now, sometimes that money you give them may not go to the purpose that you would like it to go to. It might go to a bottle, it might go to crack, it might go to weed, you know, maybe it doesn't. Because I grew up in a family of addictions, I don't give money, period. I just don't. What I do is I will sometimes carry Subway or McDonald's coupons in my pocket, or sometimes some other things so that people can get a meal. And I often carry one ride bus cards. You can go to the machine at any transit station and get them for $3. And so, look, I can't give you money, but here's a bus card. They're not gonna smoke that.
All right, Sid Cohen.
I know that you work in Illinois, but could you see any difference between what we had under Bush and we have under Obama?
What I saw was the recession. The recession definitely impacted homeless youth, families that were already squeezed when the mother's hours got cut at work, the kids were put out. I don't think it has anything to do with necessarily who was president per se, unless you blame the recession on Bush, which it started under Bush, I guess you could. Though we have a history of recessions in this country, and capitalism is known for its ups and downs, and we had to have a recession since the 70s, not really. We had a real brief one around 9/11 that actually started before 9/11. But capitalism does this, and that's the nature of our economic system. So I don't like Bush, but I can't say I really blame him for the recession. I mean, it's the nature of our economic system to have recessions. And recessions create homelessness. You know, the recession in the 70s is why there was a homeless crisis here in Chicago.
But the markets always correct themselves. Unfortunately, it's a little costly.
But sometimes at great human cost.
Exactly.
All right.
And after a long period of time.
I have a question. It was a very good question. Yes. Used to work for the homeless shelter in Evanston, volunteer, and then for the hospitality center for the homeless there. It was sort of a Cadillac of path sort of thing. Because you could stay there for a month.
Wow.
And they had shower facilities, and they watch people, and they had people awake at night to watch, and places to put your clothing and other belongings.
and programs. They had social service people and so on. How typical is that in Chicago, and is it equal on the south side and the north side? No.
Yeah, so there wasn't a homeless youth shelter on the south side of Chicago for over 30 years. When I was at the Knight Ministry, I organized a group of youth, was kind of a sidebar to my job, that the Knight Ministry was actually quite ambivalent about. And it was called Hello. And it was a youth group, they named the group, it was called Homeless Experts Living Life's Obstacles. The last year I was there, we had 75 youth in the group. So it became almost too big. We, after many, many years of speaking at city budget hearings under Mayor Daley, one of the youth, and I can't explain why to this day, but one of the youth got his attention. And she had never given a major speech before. She was actually, the way I did it, I always would have a veteran speaker standing next to a novice speaker, one of those things, because the budget hearings are very tense environments. You never know what's going to happen. You know, people are staring at your back because the microphone is towards the front of the room and you're facing the mayor and the commissioners or whatever, and then all the public is boring holes in your back. And for a youth that's been traumatized, that's really not a good situation. So I would always have the youth and myself often, if I didn't have enough youth, go up and stand behind the person so they didn't feel the holes being bored in their back while they were speaking. Well, anyway, this girl had never given a big speech before, and she got his attention. And she was so nervous that she had to go to the bathroom really bad. And so the minute she got done speaking, she made a beeline to the bathroom, which was clear across the room and out in the hallway. And he left the stage, and he followed her. So, of course, we all went after her. This is like, what is he doing? And so that resulted in him coming to a homeless youth art show that we did every year that was a public art show. He actually came, and then that resulted that the youth MC was very savvy at that event, and he made the mayor get up. I didn't actually tell him to do this either. He did this by himself. He called the mayor up to the stage, which I didn't think the mayor was going to go, so I didn't encourage him to do that. But he called the mayor up to the stage. The mayor went, and he got the mayor to commit in front of all those people that he was going to meet with the homeless youth group within a certain length of time, and he did. And that resulted in the city getting all kinds of different pots of money, including UGMA's money, which comes from the state, to put another 100 beds in the homeless youth system. Okay, so UGMA was the third shelter to open as a result of that initiative. Now there's six. Okay, unfortunately, four of us are so heavily dependent on state funds, we may not exist after December, so we don't know. But the thing is there is a discrepancy around the city, getting back to your question about services. And, you know, we're trying to get, we got some private dollars. One of the grants I wrote, one of the bigger ones that came in, was Chicago Youth Storage Initiative, where they're going to put 60 luggage-sized lockers in the hallway of what used to be a Catholic school, which is where our shelter is. And youth will have some daytime services where they can access the lockers, because youth have a really hard time holding on to their stuff. You know, every winter they lose their winter coat the minute the weather turns warm, because they have to haul everything they own on their backs all day, right? They never have wrinkle-free, dry interview clothes for jobs. They lose their school books. They even lose their state ID. In fact, the police takes them. That's a big issue with the police, stealing kids' IDs all the time. And so having a locker to put your stuff in is huge. And so we're really looking forward to that. So you were saying that was one thing, that people could store their stuff there. Right now there really isn't a good place for people to store their stuff. We do have laundry, we have showers, we have breakfast and dinner.
Okay, we have to get into rebuttals now, Bram. It's about 10 after 8.
Tim is telling us it's rebuttal time. And
Paul, can we take one last one?
Let's take one more.
He hasn't spoken before.
How many youths come from suburbs to get a job here in the city and then get stuck?
How many youth come in from the suburb?
Yeah,
about as many as come in from other states.
Susan.
Maybe 1%. Very few. Yeah, very few. Most of our youth are homegrown Chicagoans.
Okay.
All right. Russ Johnson.
Now, you've been quite critical on Rauner. Does color, tin, and mannequin have had any blame in the problem too?
They have blame for not taking care of it until now. There was a very slight tax increase that was a temporary tax increase under Governor Quinn, and that would have resolved not the whole problem, but at least half of it, if they would have simply stood up and said, we have to keep this tax increase. Hardly anybody feels it. My own self was $40. The tax increase for me was only $40, okay? I can pay $40 to keep our human services network in place, right? So, I mean, this was not a huge tax increase, but when you add up, you know, the thousands of people that live, the millions of people that live in Illinois, and the 3 million that live in Chicago, it makes a difference, right? And so, but nobody wanted to put their name on raising taxes because there was an election. Nobody would have the courage to stand up and say, we really need to raise taxes. So yeah, it's a bipartisan problem. You know, what the Democrats didn't do, now we're living with. So it's not just the Republicans, is what I'm saying. Ronner is the bad guy, but there were bad guys before him. People didn't do what they should have done.
Yes.
All right.
Well, he has 9 houses.
Problem is, if everybody kicks the ball down the road, that's how the state got into its pension problems and other budget problems. And it's not just the state, corporations do it too. The market doesn't correct everything.
Let's go to rebuttals, Brom.
The question period has ended. We're going into the rebuttal period, and I want to know how many of you want to raise your questions as comments. All right, 1, 2,
talk about Robert.
3, 4, 5.
Libertarian.
Why don't we shut off your projector?
6. Yeah, I have.
Yeah,
that's myself. 4, 7. At least 7. How much time?
We'll go about. Why don't we go to 4 minutes each, Brom?
4 minutes each.
Okay, next, let's get up and get the show on the road.
All right, and Jane Parker, you have the first lucky plug.
Thanks a lot, Ann. I was going to ask, but I suspect I know the answer, that are there other countries that do things better? We heard about the United States, and of course a lot of people think the United States in every day and every way is the best country in the world.
Yes.
Oh, yes.
Personally do not agree with that assessment. And nor do I believe that Saudi Arabia every day and every way is the best country in the world. I suspect that Germans take care of Germans, including German youth, a little better than we take care of our youth. I suspect Canada also takes care of their youth a little bit better than we take care of our youth. I suspect Sweden is pretty good, too. Now, in terms of the budget, Jane Addams Senior Caucus, One North Side, and a bunch of other community organizations are absolutely clear in saying this is a revenue problem in this state. We need to raise taxes. We don't need to cut services. We can raise taxes in many ways. We can have a transaction tax. We can close corporate loopholes. We can make the thing transparent so that we can at least shame some of these corporations that aren't paying taxes. We can reinstitute, I think Ann said that, the income tax temporary raise. We can do that. That's another thing. And you're going down the line. Now, those are the ones I would recommend. Okay. Also a graduated income tax, that's what we need in Illinois. That's the end of the ones I recommend. But we can also raise taxes on retired people who pay almost no state income tax. I pay almost no state income tax. You could start that at, say, $50,000 a year. And hey, I know personally that's around my income, that if you got $50,000 a year, in spite of what Ann said, and you're a senior, you live pretty good. So I don't see anything wrong with that. You can also take the sales tax and add services to it. Granted, some people don't want to pay tax on their haircut, but I think I could live with that. And of course, if you're getting all kinds of other services like massage and all those other services that you might get, financial services, you could probably afford to pay more. This is not a revenue, this is not a crisis of we need to cut services, we need to raise revenue. End of statement. Thanks, Sam.
Go to Russia and see how they take care of their kids.
Not wearing business friendly.
Yeah. There's a huge problem in Russia.
I'm a tourist.
Russia has a huge
problem. A few years ago, I forcibly was retired, and I found I have been volunteering at the shelter in Evanston. A couple of nights a month. And you get to meet a lot of people. And of course, I hear a lot of sad stories. Most of them most were older people. And somehow, youth got sent somewhere else, I think.
Yeah, probably.
Yeah. People were picked up by the police, and we got a lot of referrals from the police. Anyway, and they would come at all hours. Oh, well, anyway. The shelter had a meal. A free meal, evening meal, and also a free breakfast. That is a little different from some other places. And then there was some place to go to, St. Mark's Episcopal Church on, it's not Gulf Road, Ridge Boulevard, Road was where St. Mark's was, and they walked from the shelter over to St. Mark's. St. Mark's was very hospitable to us. Hospitality in many countries is just what people are expected to do, expected to be. It's a gift from God to be hospitable. A few weeks ago in my little Methodist Bible study, we found out that Albania was the one country in Europe that had more Jews after the occupation by the Germans than when they began, because the Muslim or Greek or Orthodox or Roman Catholic or whatever they were, the Illyrian people of Albania, they had what was called beta. They protected people who came to them who were refugees.
anybody. And they felt that was their duty, and they did it. Now, if everybody felt that it was their duty, but we shift duties. Oh, why don't the police take care of it? Why don't the schools take care of it? Why don't the politicians take care of it? Why don't the corporations take care of it, or the churches?
Yeah.
Well, it's everybody's problem when somebody is hurting you.
Yeah.
And, but you have to see it. You have to feel it. You have to be open to it. And most of us, most of the time, have too many problems. That's why a little condition like recession, depression, so on, throws everything out of whack. And we hide from our hurting neighbor. Okay, I think I'm going to exhaust, but I remember Commissioner, then Congressman Quinn, who said, you know, the largest hospital for people with mental problems is the city jail, the county jail. Yeah, that's where we have shifted people. Now, if you don't want to do that, you support services. And you vote for people who see to it that taxes are raised for social services.
All right. Raise taxes.
Raise taxes?
Absolutely.
No. Good evening.
Maybe she like it.
Can everyone hear me?
Yeah.
Michael Medved had a talk show. He claimed to be a Republican, and he always championed the Constitution. But when homelessness, when that subject ever came up, Michael Medved said he thought the homeless should be rounded up and put into institutions and taught a trade and one thing and another. I was foolish enough to call in that show one day and tell him that the Constitution was based on life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, and that.
Thank you.
And that people had a right to be homeless if they wanted to be, and that all homeless people were not necessarily bums, that there are artists, there are poets, and there are certain people who would choose to be homeless. And they have as much right to be homeless and be left alone as a millionaire. But Mr. Medved didn't agree with that at all. He said that anybody who's homeless, that they have no right to be on the street, that they're impeding public ways and so forth. So you couldn't win with him. But I do believe that people have a right to be homeless if they so choose. I want to point out that charity is a wonderful thing, and it helps a lot of people. But charity is not charity if it is compelled by the government. So if the government says you have to pay more taxes because we have to use that to help the homeless, that's not. Hey,
quiet!
As I was saying, that I think that charity is not charity if it's compelled. So, homelessness is a big problem, and I want to point out that there was a time in this country when food was so vast, that there was so very much of it, that it was so cheap for food. But with the input of the politicians that have run the show for so long, that's all changed. Today, food is so expensive. This isn't because that there's less food to go around. It's because that everything else, the price of everything else has been jacked up way out of proportion. Rents are sky high. Why are rents sky high? Because real estate taxes are sky high. Everything is way, way up there, and that forces the price of food to be way up there. And all of this is done artificially by our representatives in government. These bastards need to be kicked out, and we need a reassessment of the whole works, and we need to come back to a more realistic kind of a system where that people can make a living and be done with it. And if the minimum wage doesn't work, then all that proves is the whole concept of a minimum wage is ridiculous. It's superfluous, and it doesn't really mean anything.
Okay.
A minimum wage, okay, just has no place in a free market society. Thank you very much.
Well, boy.
Ann, thank you for an enlightening presentation. Enjoyed it. It was well
You're
put together.
In my
and the facts are eye-opening. And you are to be congratulated for what you're doing, you know, with your life, attempting to help homeless youth. And I'm an agnostic, so I'm not sure there is such a thing as heaven. But if there is, there'll be a special place for you there at some point. Now, down to specifics. I do have some quarrels with a few of the things you said. Regarding the tax, yeah, you said you would be happy to have the higher tax back, and so would I. But the point is not whether it's only a few dollars more for us. The point is that our income tax system now, with a flat tax, is very regressive, which is to the benefit of the rich and not to the low income. We need a progressive income tax. Here in Illinois, there are some legislators, including my Senator Heather Stein, my Rep. Kelly Cassidy, and many others, are working on getting a progressive income tax. Now, how long that'll take when we've got a Republican governor, I'm not sure. It'll probably take a while. But we do need that, and we need a higher end tax for the wealthy and a lower tax for everybody else, and to get the revenue we need, not only for homeless children and homeless people, but all kinds of other programs that are worthwhile. Now, having said that, some of the costs, I think, are crazy high, and I'd like to get these numbers from you again later that you shot out there. You did say a shelter is moderately priced at $16,000 a year. That's not too bad. But you said, I think you said the state, if it's through foster care, is $48,000 or something, $43,000, $48,000, something like that. That's more, I think that's higher than the median income, okay, for a family. And some of the numbers you shot out were over $100,000. A friend of mine and a fellow that a lot of people here know, Tony Ball, used to work in a place called, I believe it's called Thresholds down on Belmont, and they help pregnant young women, first of all, in taking care of their kids with medical issues, getting jobs, et cetera, et cetera. And he talked about some of the problems they had in getting cooperation from their clients. And the average cost, he threw out one day, the average cost is $110,000 a year. Now that would put a family pretty close to the upper 3 or 4% of incomes. So something has got to be done with these costs. You guys have it right, but
all these other places don't, and I don't know exactly what to do about that. Okay, I reemphasize again what Gene Horcher said. The problem is revenue. We've got to raise more revenue, and through the income tax is the most important. However, somebody said real estate tax is true. I don't agree with that. I think that we do need to raise income taxes. I don't have a problem with raising real estate taxes. It's kind of a net worth tax, which we need. I do have a problem with a service tax, because a service tax is, again, a tax. We should get rid of the regressive taxes, which include sales taxes, most sales taxes, not sales taxes on gasoline and tobacco and liquor and certain other things where you want to control consumption. But other sales taxes should go away. Certain, we should not have service taxes either. It should be built into an income tax. And the payroll tax, which is federal, not state, is the most regressive tax of all. And that should be gotten rid of and lumped in to a progressive income tax. Am I getting low? Okay. I'll wrap it up here. Just a couple quick quarrels with Dave Travis. On food prices, I think food prices as a percentage of income are lower now than they've been. Yes, rents are getting high, but it's not because of real estate taxes. And they're not getting high everywhere. They're getting high in certain desirable neighborhoods and in the cities because people are moving back into the cities. Much homelessness is based on mental health. I think some people have covered that. Also, I'd like to point out, I'll take just an extra 30 seconds here. Margaret Aguilar today gave a talk down at OUL, Open University of the Left, which I went to, and it was excellent. It was on abortion. She gave a history from prehistory, from 10,000 years ago until today, the history of abortion. And it was just excellent, and OUL, they have somebody like Tim who videos all of these things, and I would recommend people going, finding it, Open University of the Left, and look up Margaret's talk, because it was just excellent. Probably be on there in the next couple days. Thank you.
I remember I used to go to Howard Street to catch the bus home to Skokie, and there was a lot of homeless people there and a lot of mental cases there. And I remember my brother years ago, he had a nervous breakdown and he went into the asylum. And now I understand, I'm not 100% sure, they closed down a lot of these asylums. So homeless people and mentally ill people don't actually have a place to go. Now, right now I'm living in a nursing home, and in the nursing home you can see there's a lot of people that need to be in the asylum, and there is no place for them to go. So as a consequence of that, we have more people probably on the street, more people that are homeless, they can't find a place to live, so forth and so on. And this is not an individual problem, this is a societal problem. And like she said, when you have more unemployment, they have more homelessness. And the people that run the society say, well, it's only about 5.5% unemployment. But they were people that went into this in great detail and looked up almost every aspect of it. And in actuality, it is about a third of the U.S. working population that wants to work full-time but can't get a full-time job. So the unemployment rate is very, very high, maybe 20 up to 30%. And like I brought out before, in the United States, and that's the richest country in the world, we have something like 854 people that have as much wealth as half the population of this planet. So this is the type of society we live in. And they don't really care about the homeless. They don't care about people that are starving or anything of that nature. Look at Rounder, what he's doing. Or look at what happened under Bush. Or even under Obama. Nothing really has improved that much.
So what I'm saying is we need a different type of society that cares for everybody, not just for people to have a lot of money. Now, I was just listening the other day to Amy Goodman, and she brought out something that was very interesting. General Motors had a defect in their car, and they knew this for about 10, 12 years that there was a defect, and they've done nothing about it. And now, there's something like $900 million that are, they're going to be fined $900 million. But not one of them is going to prison, not even one of them. And this was never brought up about corporate crime. And there's so much corporate crime, and this is one of the reasons why you don't have any money. Not only corporate crime, but also they don't pay taxes. They go overseas, they got all kinds of loopholes. And if we had this type of money, we could have take care of all our problems. And homelessness is a shame. And in the industrial country, the richest country in the world, that has homelessness, something basically wrong with it.
Hey,
Rod.
My name is Raj Kotan. I speak for myself. Those who had it must have been given to them. Those who had not, what they have shall be taken away from them. I think we have big cultural problem in this country. What you told, what Abraham told about Eastern countries is different. We serve God by serving people, not by serving God, serving people. In this country, we have got wrong, because Jesus will save you. No, you save yourself by serving Jesus' children. And Jesus told so much, but churches did not take it. Big problem we have is cultural. I have fought with so many moms to take care of their kids. They said, no, he's 18-year-old, he should be taking care of himself. I said, Mrs. So-and-so, when you made a baby, and baby is forever. It is not a house you rent, and you say, well, you know, I don't like it, I go to change other one. It is not something you can go away. Apparently, lots of people are abandoning the houses, their kids. Otherwise, it will not happen. No matter how poor is mom or her mom, how poor is dad, you know, how can you give away your kid? There is something wrong. And our churches, our social institutions, our politicians are not talking about that. Take responsibility of your kid. Do not make babies if you cannot afford it. I will go as far as to say is that every service should be tested, that they can handle the kid. They can raise the kid. They have resources to raise a kid. Because time has changed. We are a technological society. Everything is so expensive, so complicated. If you do not know, you should not take a responsibility. The world is so complicated. If you fall down the wagon, it's so hard to get back. I'm talking to a friend of mine from New York. I'm from New York. And he said he wants to go back to New York. But he said, you know, it's easy to get out, but very hard to go back. Where do you live? Where do you find a job? How you do it? His rents are so expensive, hotels are so expensive, you have to first go 1 month, you have to find, stay there to find something. So unless you are somebody, you cannot go there, I don't know nobody. The homeless problem has been for a long time. I have seen it in first hand in San Francisco, if you go to downtown, out of downtown, or in Los Angeles, there is a whole skid row. I've seen in New York City, abandoned houses, you go in the evening, people were sleeping there all over. Okay, these are there, and I don't think any institution alone can solve it. Only culture can solve it, only people do not abandon. In India, in Patel society, I'm sorry, let me tell you this, Patel society is one of the most prosperous society in India, you know, and right now they are rioting. Why they are rioting? They want more educational seats because so fewer positions available. give one more jobs, okay? Because they're well educated, everything is there. But how we do it? We do it is that the we'll go our cousin, second cousin, third cousin to finance him or her to get education, to take responsibility, to make sure they come up. Okay, and it works. But in this country, oh wow, you know, my kid, you know, he's now 25 year old, he's going to be taking care of myself. People don't take care of people. Thank you.
Okay. Got four minutes. I'm next after you.
Iris.
Iris Yanovas.
I paid my tuition for tonight and put in my 2 cents worth.
Bless you.
You know, I agree with that gentleman with the red sweater that spoke earlier, you know, about all the tax inequality and things like that that create serious problems of all the regressive taxes that we have and hardly any progressive tax, and the rich are tax-free, and so the most economically weak people are the ones that are paying for everything we have. If we have policemen, the rich are not paying for those policemen. If we have firemen, the rich do not pay for those firemen. If we have streets, paved streets out there with lights in the streets, the rich do not pay for those streets. We pay for those streets, the taxpayers. And you might say, well, you don't have a job. So what kind of taxpayer are you? Well, even if you don't have a job, you pay sales taxes, you pay real estate tax, even if you don't have a house, if you rent, you pay $800 a month rent, $200 of that goes to pay real estate tax. Your landlord has to pay real estate taxes on that building. So everything falls on the weakest people in the economy and the society. And this happens in societies where, like the gentleman said before, I think said about 800 and some people who have all this wealth. Well, he omitted the theo. You know, first it's a plutocracy, but the silent partner of the plutocrats, the Trumps and the Rockefellers and all of the other billionaires are the men of God. Now, God, when the gentleman said before, he said he's an agnostic. I was a believer, then I became an agnostic, then I became an atheist. But after I read that toxic book called the Old Testament and the New Testament, I became an anti-theist. So I was born in the land of the 12 gods. So, you know, if somebody says, hey, the Holy Land, hey, I don't come from the Holy Land. They only have one God in the Holy Land. Where I was born, we got 12 gods. So, who am I supposed to defer to your one mythological god? I got 12 mythological gods. So, the thing is, in Chicago, when I take the elevator to go downtown, which I do 2-3 times a week, I look left, right, wherever I look, every few blocks or every few miles, you see a big, tall steeple with a big cross on it. To me, that is the cross of disgrace and anything that's worse in the world. Because wherever the cross rolls, South America, Mexico, U.S., that's where you find poverty, that's where you find homelessness, that's where you have rampant AIDS, child prostitution, rampant narcotics, all the social ills you can think of, and the silent partners of the so-called plutocrats are the church plutocrats. And they owe so much, they should be, I'll take an hour next time to speak on that more. Okay. So at this time, thank you for not cutting me off, Tim, and you're next.
Yeah, I'm next. All right, I got 4 minutes, and I'm going to be very brief.
First of all, Yanovas, I am going to publicly dispute your claims on that church, because tomorrow morning I am going to be at a place called Springbrook Community Church in Huntley, Illinois, which is a Baptist church where I find a lot of good people, a lot of good friends, and yes, a lot of good help, because I know a number of people personally who are very active in the community, doing good things in the community, and they're also getting some very good instruction, and they are a true community of helpful people. And I find that the more I learn about truly committed Christians and others in that line of faith, those that actually believe what they're doing, I find a lot of help. Our church partners with something with another church here in Chicago. It's in the Lawndale neighborhood. And they have something called the Hope House down there, which I've spoken with their assistant pastor when he's come here, and as a matter of fact, they do a lot of hope in there. Now, I know that some places may not be the best and help may not be around. But, you know, when I look at the scheme of homelessness, I look at the society in general, frankly, I still think that free market capitalism is going to be the best way to make jobs. I support globalization. I support a lot of the corporations, but again, you also have to have certain standards of law. You also have to have certain standards of a social safety net so that we don't let people go down and through the cracks. But for me to say that our society is a bad one, it's not a bad society. There's a lot of crooks running it, and I think a lot of what we are losing is basically a lot of those bedrock values. When you see families with a mother and a father, a commitment to marriage, and the two parents committed to raising those kids are effectively in a form of government. And the way the mother and the father, they take responsibility as their family, usually happens to have it. Now, in our country, many of you have seen the decline of the family. Now, I'm not making it, not saying anything against single moms, I'm not saying anything against gay people or anything like this, but as a general rule, if you have a stable family, two parents, hopefully a mother and a father, and kids, and then an extended family for a support system, a lot of your social problems go away. You also have to remember, too, that adolescence is basically only a relatively recent invention in the last 100 years. With life expectancy going on much longer, it does take a lot longer to get and train a person to get along in this society. In the early 1900s, there was a movement to bring high schools to in the early 19-teens, everybody had to go to high school.
Thanks.
That's what the goal was, to get everybody educated to live in a complicated society of 1910. Now it requires some college or vocational school. And the government traditionally has been the one that's provided those benefits. Many of us, maybe from the 1960s and through the early 80s, had free or low-cost schooling at state schools or colleges, and we were able to get ahead. Okay. In short, we need to, you know, it's very simple. Let's get back to being responsible citizens. Take care of ourselves. If you have somebody in need and it's within your grasp to take care of them or to help them out, do so. But don't abrogate your responsibility and let the government take over.
Yeah, don't let the government take over. What yeah, let the churches take over. Let Walmart take over. Yeah, that's better, huh?
No,
multinational corporations, we should let them take over.
Yes.
Is that what you want? Holy, yeah, that would
globalization
be. Globalization. Boy, that would be an idyllic
globalization
place
has brought more prosperity and more jobs to everybody.
All right, it's my 3 seconds. Let's thank our speaker very much for tonight's presentation again. We haven't ever done this in a while. I'll be eclectic as usual here. I was thinking, actually, I'll tell a little anecdotal story. Actually, they basically could be my cousins. And was there an incidence of homelessness? And as it turns out, they were two daughters. They lived up in Milwaukee. And the mother embraced religion, and specifically Jehovah's Witnesses. And they had two daughters. The one daughter was a pleasant enough young lady, but she took after the mother, and I must admit, perhaps was not the brightest person around. The other daughter took after the father, and she was as sharp as you could find, and an incredibly talented artist in watercolors, magnificent skills. Anyhow, of the two daughters, by the way, this mother, she also insisted that she did no cooking in the household, because her daughters were supposed to learn how to cook. And so they did all the cooking and made them. That's not a bad idea. I can't fault the mother for that. That's a good idea, actually. But nevertheless, the one daughter you took who wasn't too bright ended up with marrying a minister of the religion, and the other daughter took God, and I've never gotten in touch with her since she just had it. So yes, there are circumstances. I think she just couldn't put up with this cloak of religion that took over the household. I don't want to make light of this, but the College of Complexes is in fact a whole college if you trace back our lineage. I do know that during the Depression, we don't want to romanticize the hobos, but they were homeless youth, if I'm correct. With what I've studied of railroad history, they were, young people were told that apparently in the Depression, they simply had no way of taking care of them, so they were cast out and rode the rails. And there's videos and stories, things like that. Only at the College of Complexes can someone apparently sit through an entire lecture on homelessness, then get up here and give us this libertarian lecture on how you should abolish the minimum wage, which would only result in increased homelessness. Is there something I'm missing here? The other thing is, I actually began my career like you did in social work, and I did fight in the war on poverty. The one thing I did take back from this, there's poverty of choice, which we heard some, this oddly enough, I don't think many people exercise this choice to do, and there's poverty of circumstance. And it's almost absurd to say that there's poverty of choice. Actually, like you, I've taken in any number of guys that my sister later showed up and kicked out. She called it tough love. The other thing is, the incidence of homelessness is fully understandable to me in a free market economy, because if you are of no value unless you're producing wealth for some particular individual, and that individual will get you to work for him or to produce if he can arrive at the lowest amount of money that he can compensate you for. So there's an inherent deflation to the system to in fact keep you poor, and if they can, they don't really care if you are homeless. They don't care if you basically have the basic necessities of life, because salary and compensation is based on what they can get you to do for paying the least amount of money. Has no relevance to the real world, whether in fact it's a living wage. But last of all, I wanted to say this. There was an incidence of homelessness within my own nuclear family. As a young man, my parents ran away from home. Well, I found them and I made them come back. All right, thank you.
Speaker gets the last word. Speaker gets the last word.
What you're referring to is the. Oh, I was thinking Indy.
Yeah, go crazy around.
Oh, the old guy.
So, I want to challenge you all to do something with this today. Okay? So, there are several things that you could do, one or all. The first thing you could do is carry one of these in your wallet. And if you come across a young person who's maybe asking for a change or looks like they are pretty lost in the world, strike up a conversation with that individual. It may be pleasant, it may be not. Remember, it's not about you. If they tell you to go F yourself, it's about them, it's not about you. Okay, that's happened to me. I've handed somebody one of these. This is how to get to Eugene Scheller. Okay, and I've had somebody rip it up and call me as the C word and the B word and everything in between, right? So, but I've also handed it to probably 20 or 30 people, and that was the only time that happened. So don't take it personally if somebody responds to you in a hostile way. You may remind them of the person that beat them when they were little, or you remind them of the police officer that stopped them for no reason, or whatever it is. So it's not about you. But take this and keep it in your wallet and give it to a young person that might need a place. Okay? That's one thing you can do. Another thing you can do is there's a protest. And some of the youth I work with are actually leading the protest. And it is next Wednesday. And it's at the Thompson Center at 10 o'clock. Come and support the youth. Make sure that the youth voice is not lost in the political dialogue. Because right now it is. Okay? You know, the seniors, I'm not saying that they have it easy, but people are listening. You know, Jane Addams has been making a lot of noise. They had this thing called Moral Mondays where some people that Gene Horker and I both know got arrested, you know, and so forth. I think Gene even got arrested once. So at any rate, I've known Gene for a long time, actually. So go to the protest. I'm not asking you to get arrested. Go to the protest and just support the youth and show that it's an issue that affects the youth. It's an issue that affects you, too, and that you care about it. Last but not least, support our programs, and you can do that in any number of ways. You can hang up this in your church, community group, humanist society, whatever networks you have. This is a call for foster parents. We need more foster parents and people that are not just doing it for the check, people that are really going to be parents and stay in touch with their kids once they turn 18 and be there for them. Put this up somewhere, okay? Talk to people and say, hey, you know, I know you're thinking about having a baby. Have you ever thought about being a foster parent? And another thing is Eugene's shelter has some things that even when we were getting all of our government money, they didn't pay for things like maxi pads, toilet paper, cereal for breakfast, stuff like
Thanks,
that.
Sweetheart.
Okay. So if you are connected to a community group, have that group do a drive for the stuff. I'm not asking for money. I'm asking for the stuff. Bring us some socks. Bring us some maxi pads. Give the kids some fresh underwear. And this is exactly what we need for 24 youth for a month in that shelter. And these are things that we give directly to the youth. It's not stuff that the government, you can't write a grant for toilet paper or for maxi pads or underwear. You can't. It doesn't exist. So this is something that congregations are really good at this. There's a black urban, I don't know if they're humanists or what they are, but they did it last year and they brought in like 2 months worth of stuff. It was awesome. So, you know, whatever groups you're connected to, you know, take these and encourage the leadership of that group to do something. And that's my rebuttal.
All right, thank you.
Thank you. Close us out, Brom.
Very good.
Thank you all for coming.
Yeah.
Protest. Yeah.
And do it again sometime soon.
Well, praise, we're honored.